12 sitting out there in the yard. It's got some special meaning to both the Oxcart program and to me personally. That airplane was the first airplane used in an operational overflight, in other words, a spy mission, 131. It also was the first airplane to fly over North Korea on the hunt for Pueblo, was 131. The most ignominious thing about 131 was its last flights. I was bringing it back from Kadena, if you know where that is, it's a base in Japan, where we had the Oxcart program active with three airplanes over there. It was the last bird to come out, and it broke. And the first guy trying to bring it home, one of our fellow pilots, Ken Collins, he landed at Wake Island, which is not some sort of a pleasurable Hawaii in the Pacific, I'll tell you. Not a damn thing there, but a runway and some crabs. And us. And he got in there, and a bad fuel leak caused his abort at the tanker, and he had to land. So pretty soon, things degenerated and got worse. We tried to fix the airplane there, we were not very successful. And the decision was made to fly the airplane, that same airplane out there, 131, the recalcitrant, to try and get it to come home because it was holding up the game. It's an SR, but it's all black, it looks like an A-12, but it's not. This is at Palmdale. Touch and go. Look how high the nose is. Any higher, you scrape the drag chute on the runway. Not the drag chute, the dump chute, fuel dump. On the go. 131, 132 is down in Mobile, if you've ever seen that one down there, it's a sister ship to this one. 133 was lost in a landing accident. Anyway, this is near the end of the production line for the airplanes. They were almost all entirely the same, there wasn't really anything different about any of them, except the one called 124, this is 131. 124 was the fourth airplane built, and that was the one that had the little engines. And they also took the Q-bay, if you look up on behind the cockpit, you see a removable hatch with a periscope on top of it, see that little knob on top, there's an aft-looking periscope in there. And there's a camera in there that would take pictures back along the back of the airplane during attack. If a SAM system attack was coming on, that camera would start when the jammer started. And what they were hoping to do was get a picture of tail chases or whatever missiles might be coming up from the back. That's a losing game to get in a tail chase with an A-12. No missile that I know of could ever catch it coming up from behind, because the damn thing's going over Mach 3. This airplane, this self-same airplane, is the last A-12 to fly anywhere, and I flew it into Palmdale on one early morning in June of '68. The beauty of that was, the agency allowed the families, the pilots, the families, their kids, and everybody to go to Palmdale to see this airplane fly, and to see it land and taxi up right in front of them. And they never did that before on any program that they ever had. That was a special concession, because we asked them, can they see it? Yeah, we've been going at this thing for years and years, and the people never saw it. So they got to see it, and they got to see this one. This one here. Like I was telling Jim, when I start looking at the airplane, it's shrinking, I must be getting old quick. But it looks to me like it's getting a little smaller. I used to think it was a huge thing, especially for one guy to fly, but now it's not so big. So my outlook has changed, I suppose, over the years. I've got about 400 hours flying this kind of airplane, and they're all a thrill, they're all good fun. Like I said, maybe in the presentation, this has got to be the easiest airplane to land that I've ever been in, because the whole geometry of the thing is beautiful. The hardest thing to do with this thing is to taxi it successfully on the ground. Now, why would that be?
No brakes.
It's got brakes, but they're not worth anything. They don't stop the airplane, they're good for steering. Okay, what else? Why would it be hard to taxi? Think about it. Look where the nose wheel is in relation to the cockpit.
Oh yeah. Way behind.
You know what that means? When you want to make a turn on a taxiway, you drive your nose up over the grass and then you make the turn. Because the nose wheel that does the steering is way behind the cockpit. Didn't it?
Yeah.
I bet you never thought of that before. But anyway, that's one of the harder things to learn on this thing, is ground handling. It really is. And like I said in the meeting over there, I used to like to screw with the mechanic's thoughts, and I'd trim the rudders in, or I'd put them both on one side or something. And they'd come in and then they knew it was Murray. He's playing with their heads again. Anyway, I have special connections with this airplane because of what it did and what I got to do with it, which was last flight. So there's special memories in there. We can walk around if you like. There's some things to be seen about an airplane like this.